In a corner, sucking your finger ends. Richard! Master Richard! Master Richard!
The voice came from below, up the great staircase from the lower gallery.
Richard! It's my uncle!
In another moment, he'd be upon us, to find me with dirt under my fingernails and enough finery on my back to see me hanged. The young master stood in a daze, blood and snot running from his nose in equal measure, like to cry as any child.
He can't see me like this. Quick, we must hide. He can't.
Rachel!
If he does, I'll tell him it was I that did it. Now, come on.
We ran along corridors lined with hangings, past shuttered rooms and staircases, until...
Wait!
It lay in the shadows at a let in the wall. A great chest hooped with iron. A key at the lock.
Here.
Its lid was heavy as a church door.
That's it. Get in. Get in. I'll help you. I'll tell him I fell. It'll be all right.
It was Hyde. Or be discovered.
Please, quickly, please.
Small choice indeed.
I'll take the key. I'll come back. I will, on my honour.
Such then was my surety.
On my honour.
The honour of Master Richard Beckford. But then for such as I, in such a place, what more was I to look for?
Black Velvet by Tony Ramsay.
The chest was shorter than I. In our haste, there was not time to dispose things for my better comfort. My head was bowed by the weight of oak, my knees turned aside. One hand was at my breast, the other beneath me, in such a way they could not be brought together. So my confinement began. It was Wednesday, before midday, a week almost to the hour since I saw Master Richard and his cousin in the garden.
You can't frighten me, you know, not anymore. I'm not a child.
Of course you're not a child, Richard. If you were a child, I wouldn't have brought you. This is man's work, believe me. Now, hush!
Here. I think this must be the place.
A gardener's hut.
Are there others on this side of the house?
There's one in the park and another behind the stables, but not here.
Then this will be it for certain.
No! Don't go in yet! Not till you know what you'll find.
But I know already. I'll find mattocks and pruning hooks and
you
twine.
You see the door is shut.
Yes, what of it?
There is good reason. They'd have set a man to watch, but feared it might attract attention.
Who did?
Your own servants.
Well, why should they do that? And how would you know it if they did?
By the merest chance, dear boy.
Early this morning, I heard voices below my window. And as I can never resist the opportunity to pry into other people's affairs, I listened. That's all.
I don't believe you.
They were speaking of a carter that came yesterday from London.
Yes. There was a carter. He bought some goods for my father.
Well, they say another came with him, a poor man in search of work. He was fed by the cook and slept the night in the great barn.
What of it?
This morning they found him dead.
Then it must be reported to the justices and the man carried to the church for burial.
No! No one must know!
But they must! Inquiry should be made as to the manner of his death.
They say he died of plague.
It's not possible.
They say he was so swelled with the poison he was like to burst.
No!
So they said.
Well, no one would dare to touch him.
No one did. He was rolled onto a sheet with pitchforks and dragged out here. He's to be removed tonight and buried in the fields.
No, you're trying to frighten me.
Oh, it may be true, it may not. It's simply what I heard. But to find out, we have only to look inside. Well?
The pestilence will escape.
No. No, the vapors are heavy and lie upon the ground. We're quite safe if we don't go in.
No!
Richard. Richard, think what you're saying. If your father dies, as they say he will, then you'll be master of Thorsby. You'll have responsibilities. Do you really want your servants swearing loyalty to Sir Richard Beckford and laughing behind their hands?
Of course not.
Then you can't allow them to take you for a fool. Servants are the same everywhere. Unless you raise a stick to them, you won't have their respect. I know. Believe me. Once they see a sign of weakness, they work at it like rats at a flour sack. If you don't take care, they'll turn you into the laughing stock of Thorsby.
Very well. We'll look. But quickly, without crossing the threshold.
Bravely spoken, Cuz. An excellent plan. Now go on. Careful now. What do you see?
Nothing. It's all right. I don't think... Oh. Wait. I can't see him. He's there. I can see him.
Have a closer look, Master Richard. Do your duty. That was most foolish of you, Richard. If you have the pestilence upon your hands, I cannot in good conscience release you. I must go tell the justices. They'll decide what must be done. Farewell, brave knight. Farewell.
At first, the dark was not dark at all. Shapes moved in front of my eyes. Strange lights made of the dark itself, so that I seemed to see the windows again, or at least their pale ghosts. But these did not last. Soon even they were gone, and another dark descended. The true dark, pouring in at my eyes to fill me with its thick velvet. Such dark as never was in the hut where Master Richard lay, frightened half out of his wits by a smock stuffed with straw.
You must let me out. Please. Let me out.
Hush, Master Richard. What's the matter?
Who is it?
It's Annie.
Oh, please let me out. Okay. I'll give you money.
It's all right, Master Richard.
Look on me, Annie. No, oh no, keep away. It's the pestilence. I have the plague on me.
I touched him.
There's no one.
I touched him, Annie.
No.
I'm going to die.
No, Master Richard, you're not going to die. At least not yet a while.
Don't go in there.
No, it's nothing. Only a scarecrow to frighten the birds. Nothing more.
No, there's a man at the back.
There's no one here. Well, come in, see for yourself. It's a jest of your cousin's, that's all.
It's a scarecrow. Nothing more. It's just... No! No! No!
I heard you shouting.
No!
Master Richard.
What are you looking at?
Oh, I...
You're laughing.
No!
Stop looking at
Master
me.
Master Richard.
Stop looking, I say.
Oh, no!
Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it.
After the turning of the lock, I could hear no sound, though I strained my ears to catch the least footstep. I heard only my own breathing, which in the dark did not seem to be my own, nor that of any other. I thought I had only to lie easy till he returned, leastways, easy as my position allowed. But thinking's not saying, and saying's not doing. And oh, to lie easy in such dark.
Master Richard!
The dark changed everything. Such a hungry dark. House, field, sky, all swallowed in a moment and took away till I thought it could take no more. But no. Not content with the sky above my head, the dark came again and took the ground from under me, so that presently up and down was all confusion. I was falling. A door had opened, and I tumbled out of the light in a drop that would take me straight to the arms of the devil himself.
Master Richard!
Annie, wait!
Annie, didn't you hear me?
No.
You must have heard me. I was shouting.
The wind was contrary. I heard nothing.
You can hear me now, I suppose.
Well enough.
Good. Then bring my horse round to the front of the house. The black mare, if she can be had. I'm to ride with my cousin as far as the crossroads.
I can't.
But you must!
I'll send the boy.
Never mind the boy. I want you to do it.
Be roundabout.
Do you refuse me?
I have a sore shoulder from a hurt it took in the garden. Being the mare is like to make it worse.
Do you refuse me? You can't do this.
It's time we're on the road. There's a bed warming for me at the Dolphin in Stamford. Tonight I mean to be in it.
Annie!
I'll fetch the boy, Master Richard.
Annie!
Why the red face, cousin? Won't she have you?
I don't want her.
Then that's why you chased her halfway across the park, I suppose.
I wasn't chasing her. Why should I? She's just a gardener's daughter.
Well, what of it? If she's strong enough and young enough, you must take a stick to them, cousin. It's the only way.
No. No, it isn't.
Have you a better solution?
Yes.
And what might that be?
I prefer strategy.
I'd take a stick before strategy any day. It's so much quicker.
That's why I can play chess, and you can't.
You're welcome to your games, cuz.
They'll get you nowhere.
No, we'll see about that. We'll see.
The first pain was no pain at all, but rather such small discomforts as a body might look for. A pricking at the neck and creeping dullness that seemed to spread through my arms and legs. But slowly, the creeping and pricking grew sharper and seemed to promise worse, so that I lay afraid of what was to come, like a poor prisoner who feels the heat of the irons from the brazier.
Please, Master Richard.
And I knew then they must come soon, or they would open the lid and find Annie gone, and in her place Mad Meg, who stares at the sun and will not close her eyes. Because to close her eyes brings back the dark.
What are you doing?
No more near eyes, tell you.
It's not a pretty answer. Not for your master.
No. Well, I've work to do, so it must suffice. I've no time for hunting up fine words. Any road. Sir Francis is master here.
I'm master while he's away. Me.
And God help us.
What did you say?
Nothing.
You did, I heard you.
Then there's no need to ask, is there?
You can't talk to me like this.
No. And maybe I shouldn't. You stand there with your sword at your belt like any cavalier telling me I should show respect to the master of Thorsby. Well, would the master of Thorsby take a stave to a girl's back? For no more reason than she helped him.
Oh, that.
Yes, that.
You provoked me. You shouldn't have done that.
I did nothing of the kind.
Well, you don't think I'd do it without reason?
I don't think anything at all. I've got my work to do.
Well, never mind that now. You're to come with me.
My father's on his sickbed, and this plot must be ready for planting before the day's out.
And what if I tell you you must?
The beds still have to be planted.
They say my father is going to die.
If it's true, I'm sorry for it.
You will be, if you don't do as I tell you. Because if he dies soon, as they say he will, then Thorsby comes to me. You will have to call me Sir Richard. What do you think will happen then? You'll have to do as I say then, won't you? Who knows? He might be dead already.
What is it you want me to do?
You'll see. I need your help.
Come on.
It began to grow warm inside my prison, so that soon the sweat ran in my eyes as if the fever was on me. Each breath was a great labour and brought with it its own pain that only added to my misery. Then I thought the lid seemed to press down harder against my crown. It was a moment's fancy, nothing more, a trick of the dark, but it was not to be gainsaid. Soon I could feel the walls begin to move and by degrees to tighten their hold.
No.
All was changed then. I was in the corridor no longer, but sunk deep in the ground, with the weight of earth pressing down, starting to settle, working on the chest so that in a moment the wood would begin to crack and the dark earth come pouring in to stop my lungs. And then I cared not who would find me, so long as the chest were opened and I could see daylight once more.
Help me. Help me. Please.
We're not going inside.
Yes, we are.
Why?
Because you have to do as I say. Come on.
No. Till you tell me where we're going, I don't take another step.
Wouldn't you like to see the house?
I see all I want to see each time I lift my head. Why should I want to see more?
I could make you if I wanted to. We're going to the Long Gallery.
What for?
That's another question. You said you'd come if I told you where we're going.
No. It's not right. My father hasn't set foot inside but once in all the years he's worked here.
But he has been inside.
Yes. A year or two since. He took some tulips to show Sir Francis visitors.
Well, there you are, then. He didn't refuse, did he? Now it's your turn. Come on.
Well, still don't seem right.
You can close the door. It's this way. There. What do you think? It's one of the finest rooms in the house.
It don't seem like a room at all. Not this big. You could drive a coach and horses through here.
Yes, I suppose so, if you don't mind.
Come over here. Look at this.
Oh, it's the mistress.
Yes, my mother. You see how beautiful she was? She was 18 when it was painted. One day soon I shall hang my picture alongside.
You still haven't told me what I'm doing here.
You're going to help me.
You said as much before, but not how I'm to do it.
I will. In a moment. Do you know what this is? No. Why should you? It's a game of chess. Shall I tell you about it?
I'd assumed you told me what I have to do so I can get back where I belong.
It's a game of stratagems. A kind of battle. But a battle where the cleverest wins, not the strongest. These pieces can all move in different ways. This one is a castle. It moves like this, in straight lines. And here's a bishop. Bishops take the diagonals. See?
That one's like a horse.
Oh, it's called a knight. Knights jump, like this. Their job is to protect the king. You'd think the king was the most powerful, wouldn't you?
Oh, I suppose.
Well, you'd be wrong. He's slow, old, worn down by the cares of state. He can barely limp along. But this one, this is his queen. The most powerful piece on the board. The queen can go anywhere. She can do anything.
But what about these little ones?
Oh, those are pawns. The foot soldiers. They can only go one step at a time. They're the weakest pieces.
Aye, and they're the first to fall, I expect.
Yes, usually. But sometimes, something wonderful happens. Sometimes a pawn goes deep into his opponent's territory. Maybe it's protected by stronger pieces, or it just slips through without anyone noticing. A moment comes when nothing can stop it reaching the other side. And do you know what happens then? The pawn, this little pawn that no one noticed, turns into a queen. Imagine that, Annie. Imagine being turned into a queen. Would you like that?
Me? A queen?
Why not? Well, not a queen, perhaps, but why not Mistress of Thorsby?
I don't know what you mean.
Yes, why not? How would you like to be mistress of Thorsby for a while?
Don't be silly.
We could play a game.
But I don't know what you're talking about. No more do I want to. Such games have nothing to do with me.
It's only what we did when we were small.
We were children then and you know better. You shouldn't be asking me now.
You don't understand.
I understand well enough that my place is outside in the garden, not in here.
No, wait, Annie, listen, I mean it. I'm to go to London soon. Very soon. Perhaps even tomorrow if my uncle arrives. Things will be different there. I'll have to meet people, entertain them. It's not at all like life in the country. I have to be ready and I want you to help me.
And how am I to do that?
Well, it won't be difficult. All you have to do is pretend a little. Sit in a chair, walk up and down. Let me show you round.
Me?
You?
That's all?
That's all?
No.
Oh, it would help me, Annie, please.
And how long's it going to take?
No time at all, half an hour. You can be mistress of Thorsby for half an hour. What do you say?
Well, if that's all you
want... I swear it. And you can go back directly to your seedbed when we finish.
And it don't take no longer.
It won't.
Then...
Excellent. Now, take my arm. Go on, it's all right. That's it.
What now?
We're going to walk. View's very fine, don't you think, Mistress Anne? You can see right across the park from here. Not so tight, you're squeezing.
Nay, when you walk out with someone, you hang on tight or you like to lose them.
Not if he's a gentleman and she's a lady.
Lady indeed.
Did you know, madam, there are almost 100 rooms at Thorsby?
I'd know, if I was mistress. Well,
then you'll have to be someone else. Oh, you can be my cousin from London.
If you say so.
Yes, 100 rooms.
Almost?
Almost 100. When the king came to stay, there was light in every one. The whole place was full of the finest people. It'll be like that again one day. You'll see. Is this what it's like? Walking out with someone?
No.
Why not?
Don't know. Don't feel right, that's all. It's this house. And these big windows.
Don't you like the house?
It don't feel like a house. Not this big.
There are 5 hearths along this room. You should see it when the fires are burning and the lights lit. You'd like it then.
I'd like it well enough when I'm outside and back at work.
Are you, walking out with someone, Annie?
That's for me to know. Besides, I thought I wasn't Annie now.
No, of course. That's not what we're here for. Well, Mistress Anne, I think it's time we had a little music. It's out of tune, but it will do. It's still the finest instrument in the county.
That's a pretty sound.
It had once.
Will you not play something?
No, it's for the ladies to play. Here.
I can't.
Sit down. There. Now, go on. Play something. Come, Mistress Anne, you play very well. I heard you play at Lady Kirby's, don't you remember? Will you not give us 8 is in my mistress's face? Or come fill the cup?
Don't!
Well, surely you'll give us something.
No!
Oh, Mistress Anne, I insist.
Stop it.
Play, Mistress Anne, don't keep us waiting. Play something.
Stop!
Play!
No!
Thank you, Mistress Anne, thank you. That was delightful.
I want to go now.
Oh, not yet.
I must!
No!
Quite soon I'd lost the hand that lay beneath me. After the first numbness and pain, I'd been left with no more than a burning at my shoulder that at times blazed bright like a fire in the wind and as soon died again. My other hand was at my breast. I know not how, perhaps a settling or twisting of the joints, I began to find that some slight movement was become possible. By slow degrees, and at some cost to the skin on its back, I drew my hand to the hollow space at my side. At once, I felt the cold edge of the lock, the harsh instrument of my confinement and bar to my liberty. I began at once to work at its mount, prising and tearing at the grain of oak. I did not stop when my nails had gone, nor yet when the fingers broke down. My labours were ended only when the hand would not bend, and had so begun to shake against the side that its knocking could not be stilled.
You
to show you. You're very lucky. No one else in the house is allowed through this door.
Why?
You'll see.
I'm not going in there.
Why ever not?
And there's no way you can make
it. It's only a bedchamber.
I can see fine what it is. And I'd be as big a fool as ever walked the earth to go in.
I was born in that bed. It stood just where it stands now. That window was the first thing I ever saw in the world.
You were born in there?
Yes.
Then this was the mistress's room?
My mother's. Yes. You don't have a mother, do you, Annie?
No.
She died?
Yes.
Do you remember her?
I was 3 days being born. I lived, God forgive me. She died. I knew nothing about her. But I remember the mistress.
Do you? Tell me what you remember.
She were tall. I remember that. Near as tall as your father.
Go on.
And her hair was all curls. Lovely curls they was. As black as the night sky. Just like in the picture. She talked to me when I was small.
Did she? What did she say?
She used to come into the gardens. The gardens were different then, all clipped tight and weeded. She used to walk in the early morning. No one else about but the servants.
But what did she say?
Oh, I don't know. Foolish things. How I was growing to look like a princess. How one day I'd marry a fine gentleman. She used to let me walk with her sometimes.
Did she ever sing?
Sing? Why? Not as I can remember.
She had a beautiful voice. Everyone said so. People always wanted to hear her sing and play at the keyboard. I was 4 when she died. I don't remember anything she said to me.
You were small. You can't expect it.
And yet you do.
Well, I were 2 years older.
I only know what she looked like from the portraits.
I wouldn't know my mother neither. As for pictures, there were none of those. Don't you remember anything?
Yes.
What's that?
Come through to the dressing room. There's something I want to show you. Oh, it's all right. Leave the door open if you like. Come on. Everything's here. Everything.
Oh, but they're so pretty.
You can touch them.
Can I?
If you like. You see this gown?
Yes.
She wore it the night the king came.
Oh, I remember. My father carried me from my bed and we stood outside under the cedar looking at the house. Oh, it was like a fairy palace with all the lights. He never said a word. Just stood and looked in the cold. Then he carried me home to my bed. In the morning, I thought I'd been dreaming.
And this? She's wearing this in the picture in the gallery.
Oh, that's a pretty one too.
Oh, they all are, all of them. Which do you like best?
Lord, how could anyone choose? This scarlet, perhaps. Oh, look at this one. It's like gold. Oh, I think I'd choose this one.
No, you're wrong. This is the finest.
No. That's black, like morning. Something brighter.
No. This is the one. This. It's velvet. Black velvet. Feel it. Oh, look how it catches the light. Here. Feel it against your cheek. What's it feel like?
It's soft. Very soft.
It's beautiful. It's the most beautiful dress in all the world. There isn't a finer gown in all England, or anywhere else for that matter. Not than this one. Here, take it.
What for?
Put it on.
What?
Put it on.
No!
You will put it on.
I will not.
Oh, but you will. Is your father at work today?
You know he isn't.
And why not?
He's sick.
They say he's always sick.
That ain't true. He's an old man. He's worked all his life at Thorsby for your father and his father before
they
him.
They say he's too old. Oh. He'll never work in the gardens again.
I can do his work and more besides.
Gardening isn't woman's work. Oh, but it needs a man. And if we were to get a man, he'd need somewhere to live. The only place he could go to is your father's cottage. Your father's too old, Annie. It's only charity keeps him here. So, you must take care. You must do as you're told. Now, put it on. I'll be next door when you're ready.
So poor and yet so rich in pain. Tearing pains at my shoulder. A burning where my knees met and lay fast against the walls. A pain like a knife going in at my back. And all the time an iron band tightening around my neck. I knew I must not give in to the pain. It was not my pain. It did not belong to me. It was someone else's, not mine. Someone would be along directly to take it back. I had only to wait a while longer. But I could not wait. In the hot dark, in such an embrace, no one could wait. No one.
Come out. Further.
This ain't right.
Let down your hair.
It's not fair neither.
Shh.
I ain't.
Walk up and down. Over to the window.
If anyone should see
me. No one's going to see you, only me. Again. The Black Queen. It's the Black Queen's dress. It's beautiful. Would you take my arm, Mistress Anne?
No. There'll be no Mistress Anne in me from now on.
You didn't mind in the gallery. You enjoyed it.
That was before, not now. I'm not performing like a terrier at a fair.
You can take my arm anyway. Go on, take it. That's better. How does it feel, the dress?
Too long. I keep catching my foot.
No, how does it feel to wear it? What does the dress feel like on your skin?
I can't say.
Is it soft? It feels soft. Your arms feel soft. Here, sit down at the window. I'm going to tell you about this dress. Do you want to hear?
You know fine what I want, and that's to be gone from here with my own clothes on my back.
I'm going to tell you anyway. About my mother. I can remember her wearing it. One night in the Long Gallery, there was company. I don't know who. Oh, not the king, that was later. Company from the country round about. The lights were all lit. It was dark outside, and the whole gallery was bright with candlelight. She was sitting at the harpsichord. I was standing at her knee, and the company round us watching and listening. Can you see it, Annie? And then, I don't know why, perhaps it was the music or her voice or something else, I started to cry. My mother didn't stop singing. She went on. And I went to her. And lay my head on her lap. Like this.
No. You mustn't.
On the velvet. This is how it felt. Just like this. I remember how it felt on my cheek. And she went on singing. And I remember the warmth. And the softness. And the sound of her voice as she stroked my hair. And you know what else I remember? What I remember most of all? I remember the smell. Like a spice box. Sandalwood and rosewood and spices. It was so beautiful. Then the song ended. And do you know what they did? They laughed. All of them, they laughed at me, just like you did.
No.
Yes, you did, outside the hut. They laughed until I got up and ran from the room.
Oh, Master Richard.
Oh, you think it's foolish, don't you? A boy crying at his mother's knee. What sort of a man does that make him, eh?
I don't at all. How could I? I wish I had half such a memory of my own mother.
I don't know why I cried, except she was so beautiful, and the song was beautiful, and the lights, and the smell of sandalwood, and you laugh. Everyone always laughs.
No!
You thought I looked foolish. Me? Ha! Well, come over here, Annie.
Go!
Look in the glass. No! You're wearing the most beautiful gown in the world. My mother's gown. She was tall, with beautiful hair that fell in curls. She had skin like milk and a smell like spices. Look! What do you see?
I don't know.
What can you see?
I don't know.
You're not tall. You're short. So the dress trails on the ground.
I can't help that.
And look at your hair. Look at it.
Let go.
It's thin and straight. It's dirty.
Stop it!
Dirty like your hands. Look at your hands. They're black.
I've a garden to look after. It's the colour of work. Not that you'd know that.
And your arms? No. There's too much flesh on them. Ugly, red flesh like a pot woman's. And do you know what else?
Let go of me!
You smell. Oh, Annie, how you smell. You stand there in the most beautiful dress in all the world with your thick arms and your hair and your dirty hands and you smell like a stable yard.
Why, yo!
Take it off.
I will too.
No! Here, now. You don't go another step in that dress. Take it off.
I'll not take it off in front of you.
You'll do as I say.
You'd show your sword to a girl. Why? What a fine man you are, Master Richard Beckford.
I'm warning you.
You're not man enough for anything else. Is that the way of it?
You'll do as I say.
Is that the way of it, Master Richard? Because if it is...
Take it off. Take it off. Take it off.
My nose is bleeding. Oh, look, it's broken.
To deserve such treatment, such pain and such dark. I could have left him there, crying in the hut in terror of a scarecrow. Instead, I open the door and from my pains take a blow from a garden stave. Yes, I came in the house, which is a bad thing and not right, but only at his bidding. How was I to say no to the master? I played at Mistress Anne. That was out of my place, and God forgive me for it. But does that warrant such treatment? It was all at his bidden. The games, the dress. He raised a sword to me. To a girl. Is that the reason? Is that my crime? It couldn't have happened to a man or boy, no. Must I lie here suffering the torments of the damned? For no more reason than I was born a woman.
Please, Sir Richard, please.
I cannot tell how long I lay. Time means nothing in the dark. There's no daylight, no night time. Nothing to mark the passing of the hours. Only a terror and a pain I thought would never end. But there was an end to it. Pain had its own death. When it's done its worst, the body grows numb and stops complaining. 'Twas a relief I had not looked for, nor expected to see. Now, too, the worst of the heat was past. My lungs no longer protested at the air. A chill had settled on me, an endless cold, constant as the dark itself. And thus, for a space, I lay. Only the dark remained. Dark without end, time without end, and the cold. And then I heard them outside, taking implements to the hard oak, working at the hinges, tapping and banging and prising. If I'd had the strength, I would have cried out. Oh, how long? How long did they keep me waiting? Were they men or moths that they should be so long about it? And why not the key? Why all the scraping and filing when a few good hearty blows would have done the job at once? And then, at last, a crack of daylight, so bright, so beautiful and bright.
Now, let's see what we've got.
Wait. That's it.
What on earth?
Oh, my God.
Get the lid back.
Bloody hell.
Well, well, well.
Oh, God. It's laughing. It's got hair.
I think we'd better get Dr. Fraser on the phone. He wants to see this.
What's it doing in there?
Good question. I don't suppose this chest has been opened since, well, 17th century anyway. Perhaps earlier. Locked, no key, stranded in a corridor with all the other stuff. Not surprising, really. No. Don't touch.
I wonder who he was.
Who she was, Robert. What? You see this cloth? There and there. I'd say she was wearing a dress.
A woman?
Mm-hmm. Well off, too. Yes, I do believe that's velvet.
Bloody hell.
Yes, so you better mind your language, Robin. It seems we have a lady on our hands.
The sun. Look at it, Mac.
Hello, Tom. It's David. I wonder if you'd like to come down. We've got something I think might interest you.
Pouring in at the window, like all the riches of the Indies. Never such dark. Oh, never such dark again.
In Black Velvet by Tony Ramsay, Rachel Atkins played Annie and Richard Pierce, Master Richard. Chris Scott was the cousin and James Taylor, the uncle. Technical presentation was by Tim Sturgeon, Paul Reed and Julian Walther. Black Velvet was recorded on location at Tythrop House in Buckinghamshire. The director was Janet Whittaker.
Next week, a five-part serial begins, set in the not-too-distant future. Planet B is a virtual world of infinite possibility, where the software is coming alive. Whoa, imagine that. It'd be like having everyone you follow on Twitter in your house. That'd be a nightmare. I mean, I follow Richard Dawkins and God. They'll never get on.
BBC Radio 4 Extra. The Seventh Dimension.
Next up, a rather charming...